afternoon, everyone, and welcome to our annual Saints Hall of Fame press conference to introduce our class for 2019. First of all, I want to recognize our board members who do such a great job, quite a few of whom are here today, and give a shout out to each and every one of them, and particularly thank Jay Romig, who does such a great job for us in all capacities and now serves as our chairman of the board, and Michael C. Hebert, who is not only his work does such wonders for the museum, but also serving as our president now and doing a terrific job. So special thanks to them. The actual induction will take place on October the 25th. The game will be the Arizona Cardinals home game, the weekend of the 25th through the 27th. So that's when the actual induction will take place. We have our events in Biloxi coming up tomorrow and Friday, which include four events that our honorees will be part of over there as well, which has been an annual outcome on a weekly, on a yearly basis, which has been very good for us. With regard to today, we're blessed to be able to introduce three very special people that have made all this possible over the years with their contributions. It's my pleasure, first off, to recognize our first honoree for this year. Very special person, and she was born and raised in our state and has done a remarkable job serving in every capacity she's been asked to serve in, including as lieutenant governor for two terms and then as governor of our state for a great job between 2004 and 2008. Of course, when the Saints were faced with the crossroads of an incredibly difficult circumstance, as we all were back in 2005, she stepped up in a tremendous way to be able to help our football team to return to our city. It's something that we haven't forgotten. And I think it speaks to the character of the individual, because it wasn't about politics, wasn't about doing the expedient, prudent thing to be popular with people in North Louisiana or Central Louisiana or anywhere else. It was all about trying to improve the lives of people here and ultimately throughout the state. Superdome got done and repaired largely because of her efforts and Doug Thornton as well, whom we've honored previously. Most of you know that she has quite a battle on her hands, but she's a woman of faith who believes strongly that God will provide regardless, and she's here today, and that's a miracle in itself, because as many of you have read, rumors of her demise were greatly exaggerated in recent weeks. And she's here today as a living testimony of that. It's my pleasure to introduce our Joe Gemelli Florida Lee Award recipient for 2019, the Honorable Kathleen Blanco.
Well, thank you, Ken. It's certainly a huge honor for me to be here today, and I am more than thrilled simply to be here today. I do have a lot of challenges ahead of me, and I'm going to plan to be here in October. Yeah. as I was looking at these wonderful honorees that I'm sharing this day with, I looked at our history, and we all came to the Saints in a greater, more intensified way in 2006. And that was the year immediately following the storm. Now, I had known Tom Benson before. I knew Gail. And I've, you know, been to many Saints games. But in that period after Katrina, it became imperative that we all had to call on the deepest parts of ourselves to do the most intense work that any of us had ever thought about having to do. And that was to recover an entire community, a city, a region of the state that had been totally devastated. In my mind, when every time I looked at the Superdome with the roof just ripped across it, it was the symbol of despair. And I thought, if we drive around every single day looking at the symbol of despair, we're all going to despair. And we've got to change that image and make this a symbol of victory. Now, that didn't come without me having to pay a price for being told that I had the wrong priorities, using money for a stadium. But at the same time, I knew the value was greater than just building a building, that this city and this region and Saints fans everywhere really needed to have something to rally around. And after a year of hard work, people who were rebuilding their homes and their businesses and all of that really needed a place to rally and to express joy. And that is what we found. And gentlemen, You led this community. Coach, you did a wonderful recruiting job. You picked some an amazing team that really took us further than anyone had imagined, but that everyone had hoped we could get actually to the Super Bowl. But that September game against Atlanta was undoubtedly the most exciting game this city has ever experienced in its history. People on the streets were just dancing all afternoon. It's like their feet were hardly touching the ground. They were so excited. And then you won so magnificently. What can I say? Thank you, thank you, and thank you. It's been a great life, and I'm glad to have been able to play a small part in making all of this happen.
Yeah, so
thank you, Gail. Appreciate it.
But since she's already assured us that she's going to be here in October, we'll present it to her again.
I'll be here to see you.
Yeah. Give to me too.
Yeah.
To make this happen on an annual basis, it takes a collection of people. We've already recognized our board members, but the New Orleans Saints organization is paramount in what we do. It's obviously why we exist. And Gail, of course, is instrumental in leading that and allowing us to do what we do on a day-to-day basis to preserve and present the history of this franchise in the most positive fashion imaginable. There's also people in this room that help make this possible. Mickey Loomis has been a godsend for us. He understands the history of the league, he understands the history of the game, and he has been tremendously cooperative and helpful in every endeavor that we have, from all the different events that we have, and he'll actually be in Biloxi with us tomorrow. We deeply appreciate Mickey for what he does on an annual basis. And then, of course, with regard to the next gentleman I'll introduce, needless to say, as Kathleen alluded to, we were all kind of bottomed out in 2005, then this new coach arrived, and we were all saying, wow, first time head coach, man, I don't know what's going to happen there. We all know what's happened since then. It's been a godsend for our city, our region, and beyond. And aside from that, you speak about somebody that has a tremendous understanding of the history of the game and appreciation for the guys that played this game, not just here in New Orleans, but guys that played 20, 30, 40 years ago. A quick aside for 20 seconds, and then I'll introduce him. Tom Dempsey, of course, who still lives here and has been in care now for quite some time, was, of course, a famous person in New Orleans Saints history. When he first got here, he asked me, you're not against touch with Tom Dempsey? I said, sure do. Put him in touch with him, and he told the story about how Dempsey stopped and signed an autograph for him when he was a kid at a game in Philadelphia. Never forgot that. Became friends with Dempsey, and I think that illustrates just what kind of relationship he has with former players and his appreciation for the game. Beyond that, his support of the Hall of Fame is tremendous and unparalleled. He's always there to help us in every occasion imaginable, and we deeply appreciate him. So here to present our two Hall of Fame honorees for this year is New Orleans Saints head coach, Sean Payton. Sean?
A couple notes here. I just kind of folded up this little flyer because I think it's better to share some good stories about our inductees today while they are still clear in my mind. You're reminded of your age when players that were in your first draft class now are being inducted or receiving much-deserved honors like this. And then you see their families and their children, and you're like, holy cow. There is some irony today that we're honoring the first pick of our 2006 draft and the last pick of our 2006 draft. So they arrived here in a little different way, and I'll start with Reggie's story. And it wasn't too long ago at the Greenbrier training camp. I think there was 10 of us, assistant coaches and players that had been with the organization 10 years straight, and we had a little dinner one night, and I kind of did the same thing. To the best of my memory, kind of recalled how each individual coach or player, at least how I perceived that story to be, how they arrived or became a part of the organization. So starting with Reggie back in 2006, it was our first draft. Generally speaking, when you get hired as a new coach and you come in and you're working, Mickey and I closely with the scouts, I'm going to say probably, 2 months, 3 months, and you're looking at the roster closely. And look, we held the second pick of the draft in most of the rounds that year. So we spent a lot of time, and we would always have this, what I would say we would always have, later to be known, we'd always have this, good day meeting with Mr. B and Mrs. B, but go through with Mr. B, these first round selection candidates to keep him abreast as to. We'd watch some films, some cut-ups. He'd have great questions. We'd have a printout of all the players. And I recall that year, this was my first draft with the organization, of going through a number of talented players and kind of covering them all. And that was back then in 06, it was a 2-day draft. So I think we went rounds 1, 2, and 3. In fact, I know we did 1 through 3, broke that evening. And then we would come back with 4, 5, 6, 7. And so as we were leaving the facility, the draft was the next morning. We were having what's become now our annual night before dinner, before the draft. And we get there, Mickey, myself, and the other guys that are in charge of pro or college personnel, the evaluation experts, and discuss several things. And so on my way to that first dinner, I had received a call, pretty good information. And back then we weren't, BlackBerry and you were kind of hip. That was it, So I had a Razor flip phone. And, man, out of nowhere, I get this information that the Houston Texans are going to pass on Reggie Bush. And two things went through my mind. A, I was ecstatic. And then B, I thought, man, I don't know that we covered Reggie with Mr. B because we were expecting Houston to take Reggie. And so right away it was like, holy cow, we'll get him up to speed. So I'm one to always take advantage of an opportunity. And so we got there to the restaurant, and it was important, I felt like, to kind of have this poker face. And prior to going to the restroom, I just said to the group, I got this feeling that we're going to have an opportunity to draft Reggie Bush. Anyone want some of that bet? And this is the type of bet Loomis likes, where he knows the answer. He knows he's already won, right? So I had 5 bets for $20 a man. I went to the restroom. I came back, and there were 4 20s sitting at my place. And word had broke about that opportunity. And so the next day there was – look, and I say this with respect to every player that we signed and drafted that year, to include Drew Brees, Scott Fujita, Marcus Colston. But we were kind of in that stage in the hiring process with coaches, celebrating each little small victory. We'd get a coach to come, and like we'd ring a bell and put a circle around his name, and he's in, because there were so many other challenges. And so all of a sudden here we have a chance to really select probably one of the most, if not the most dynamic college football player that our country has seen prior to social media, really. Prior to social media, because it was still text and emails. And a Heisman Trophy winner, national champion. And I remember getting in that morning, and look, we had a meeting with Mr. Benson and brought him up to speed. And then, there were a few guys talking about, well, what can we get for this draft pick? And Mickey and I were like, man, we're not trading this pick. So here it came time for that selection, and many of you in this room were here. I would say on a 10 Richter scale, the selection of Reggie Bush was a 9-9 for this organization. If you have a clear memory, you remember the crawfish boil across the street, you remember season tickets being sold out within 2 hours, and they have been ever since. That selection, that's pretty dynamic. This was Elvis Presley or Michael Jackson of the Beatles. Seriously, that's how big it was. And so Look, I came here as a new young head coach with a number of rules that Parcells instilled upon me. And, you know, he talked about, man, that first pick of the draft, make sure you fly him in commercial with the rest of the draft class. That first pick of the draft, don't have a separate dinner or hotel suite or limousine awaiting for him. And so here we are after the first three rounds. There's a little rain on the ground. The Zurich was in town, and we are heading. Peter King was in the car. Of course, he was doing a feature story, and we were heading to Emeralds in a limousine. Reggie had just arrived private and then was going to be staying at the Lowe's penthouse suite, and I thought, I've broken like every rule in the book regarding this first pick, and I've only been here 2 months. I mean, Bill's not going to talk to me. We walked into the restaurant. It was still damp, and as soon as the doors opened, there was just a chant, and it was this started slow, Reggie, Reggie, Reggie. And then we worked our way back to the back left section, if you're familiar with Emeralds, and I would say seating approximately 30 people, and we were at one round table, 12 people, and I sat, Reggie was to my left, and he turned to me and said, Coach, you did this all for me? And I just looked at him. I said, there's some serious de-recruitment that's going to have to take place with this guy. I mean, he was just, as young as he looks now, he was that young. And anyway, it proved, and there's an old smart evaluator that once told me, when you win a championship, every single transaction that takes place leading up to that championship becomes validated immediately relative to what your goal is. Your goal is to win a championship. In that playoff run, the Arizona game, two things happened in that game. I was ecstatic for how he played. I mean, he had over 250 all-purpose yards, and yet I remember him carrying out the baseball bat that was like our secret and thinking, holy cow, there's going to be questions about that. But an amazingly, amazingly dynamic player, an amazing teammate, a guy that was obviously a huge part of what we build here just from the very foundation of getting started. And it was the first, like, man, ring the bell, ring it three times. It was a big deal for our city to have that opportunity to select Reggie Bush, and then to see the success he had with us. Just a dynamic punt returner, a very good running back, a very good receiver, and here we are winning a Super Bowl championship. And you look back and look, one by one, we're going to hit this draft class, right? Streep was here last year. He was in that draft class. One by one, all of those guys that were selected became, and you don't realize it at the time, they became so necessary to achieve what we wanted to achieve. And so they were the pillars, essentially, of what we were going to build. And there were a lot of things that went in our direction, good fortune sometimes. But that story, as I'm telling it, I think is pretty accurate. Pete, yeah. I'm just going to – CJ, there's a few guys back there that, you know, at some point we're going to get a little blurry with our stories, and at least it's on paper now. So it's with great honor on behalf of the Bensons, it's on behalf of Dennis Lauscha, and our organization that Reggie Bush is entered into the Saints Hall of Fame. Congratulations.
That's funny, the stories that Coach is telling. You know, I did turn to him and ask him, like, did you guys do this just for me? You know, because it really just felt, when I walked into Emerald's restaurant and everybody stood up, I thought it was, like, pre-planned. And later to find out that it wasn't. But, you know, that was, to me, that is my first memory of coming to New Orleans, is the people welcoming me with open arms, this young kid from San Diego, California, who went to USC with high hopes of, you know, winning the Super Bowl somewhere, and it happened to be here with the Saints. And I remember the first time I landed and got to New Orleans, and I was taken on a tour throughout New Orleans through the Ninth Ward to see a lot of the devastation. And right away, you know, I felt this sense of responsibility to give it 110% every day, every time I stepped on the field, and to at least, you know, do my very best to try to bring the city, this organization, the Super Bowl. And fast forward to, you know, 4 years later, and we were able to do that. And it's, you know, I truly believe that everybody that came to this team during that time period was brought here for a purpose to help, you know, bring back hope, help restore hope into the city, to the people, by going out and doing what we do best, you know, playing football, you know, winning football games. And it's amazing, you know, when you have that opportunity to be able to do something like that, and you look back on it and you accomplished it with the guys, you know, like Coach Payton, Colston, Pierre Thomas, you know, Lance Moore. I can go on and on. You know, Roman Harper, the guys that are still some of my best friends to this day. And it's funny, I was texting, I'll tell you a quick story. I was texting Marshall Faulk 2 days ago, and I just told my wife the story as well. So when I was growing up in San Diego, I lived very close to San Diego State University. And so there's a couple of people that you wanted to be like, if you were, you know, if you were an athlete, you know, growing up in San Diego. It was either Tony Gwynn, Junior Seau, or Marshall Faulk. And so for me, I lived on 54th Street, and it runs directly at San Diego State University. And so we lived across the street from a guy named Kyle Turley, who I know everybody here is very familiar with. And so I remember he lived in an apartment building. We lived in like this duplex. And when my stepdad, you know, kind of found out who he was playing at San Diego State. He hadn't gotten drafted yet. We became friendly. So my dad would say hi to him from time to time. And you know, I remember, so when he got drafted, we found out the news that he got drafted number one to the Saints. He brought me back a signed Saints hat and a signed Saint t-shirt. And I was probably about 11, 12 years old at this time. And, you know, he didn't know, you know, if I was going to go on to be, you know, play college football or play, you know, at the professional level. And so when I look back on that time, you know, living across the street from Kyle Turley and him bringing me back that signed Saints hat, that signed Saints shirt, to me, it was almost like God's wink, like, this is, you know, your future. And, you know, something that I'll never forget, because he didn't have to do that for me, right? But, you know, a lot of times you know, I feel like we get a chance to make impacts on either it's kids or just other people, and you never know, you know, what they're gonna, you know, end up being, or who they're gonna, you know, end up impacting. And so, and then also Ricky Williams is from my area as well. And so Ricky, I've known his family for a long time, but it's funny, me and Ricky have never met, and we're from the same area, and we both have taken similar paths at the NFL level. He got drafted to the New Orleans Saints, traded to Miami Dolphins, and also won a Heisman Trophy. And again, you know, I've had, you know, kind of these little hints, these little winks, I think, that have come from God of just kind of, this is your future as well. And so, you know, when I look back on just, you know, those things in my life, those left such an impact on my life. And then the Marshall Faulk piece is, you know, obviously Marshall's from New Orleans. And so when I got to the Saints, we studied a lot of Marshall Faulk stuff, his routes. So a lot of, you know, and Marshall's one of my good friends now to this day. Even at the college level, you know, I studied a lot of, you know, Faulk stuff. And so the other day I was going through one of my old crates of a bunch of high school cut-ups and you know, college cut-ups, and I came across this VHS tape, which is kind of funny because my kids will never know what VHS tape is. It's a VHS tape of Faulk cut-up. And so I sent a picture of it to him, and I had to thank him, because I told him that, you know, he really, you know, paved the way for guys like me, right? I studied a lot of his option routes, a lot of things that he did, and a lot of his run plays. And so we studied a lot of his stuff at the college level, at the NFL level. And he's also from New Orleans as well. And so then there's, my mother was raised in a foster home. And so my grandmother, who I knew to be my grandmother, was also from Louisiana. And she really, you know, I didn't know a whole lot about Louisiana and the cooking, the Creole cooking food, all different things down here. But it's like I've had all these little different pieces of New Orleans, you know, in my life from the time I was a baby. And, you know, and so then to be able to come here and to win a Super Bowl and to be, you know, to be a part of history. It's just really cool, and I'm so appreciative to be here now. You know, New Orleans is home away from home for me, and I couldn't be happier to go into the Saints Hall of Fame with Colston. You know, just was such a big piece of what we did. You know, we were just talking in the hallway just about some of the games that we had, and that year we won the Super Bowl. It was just an amazing run. It was just an amazing time. I remember. You know, when we did win the Super Bowl, seeing the TV screen, I don't know what TV it was, it literally looked like the city was on fire. Like, people were just running up and down the streets, celebrating, coming together, people crying in tears, laughing, cheering. And, you know, that's what sports is about. It's about, you know, bringing together people from all different cultures, all different walks of life, different religions, different personal beliefs, and coming together all for the same common goal. And that's to win a Super Bowl. So thank you guys for you know, being so gracious to me, my family. This is truly home away from home for me. And, you know, I'll always have a spot in my heart for the city of New Orleans. So thank you.
In that de-recruitment process, you know, Reggie would do something pretty amazing on the field. And you know, there was that part of you as a coach that said that was pretty good. But, you know, I was at San Diego State when he was having a chance to meet Kyle. And I coached Marshall. And so CJ recruited Marshall right from New Orleans here. So there were these other ties. And, you know, we'd look at each other and be like, you still got a ways to go to get to where Marshall Faulk's at. You know, like the same thing we're telling Kamara. So our next recipient, I mentioned at the beginning the significance of that draft class, and I think it's important to go through it again, and Mickey helped me out, though, but obviously Reggie in the first round, the second round pick, we actually traded down middle of that second round, 4 to 5 spots, and acquired Jeff Fain, and selected Alabama's Roman Harper, and that was a pretty good round where we got two players. I don't know that we had a third round pick. I don't think we did. So day one ended, and we went to bed that night, you know, kind of with the board listed as to how we're going to start the next day. And we went home with the idea we were going to select Owen Daniels, tight end from Wisconsin. He also just ironically happened to be from my hometown. So the morning starts. We're eating breakfast. We've got one pick here. Houston Texans are going to select, and we're going to be on the clock. I'm actually on the phone with Owen Daniel. We're talking. I'm saying, you know, here in about 5 minutes, we're excited. And all of a sudden, you know how you're on the other end of caller ID? Anymore, sometimes you can't hear it, but there was a time where you just felt like click. And he's like, 1 second, coach. And he came back. He said, coach, you won't believe this. And he said, the Texans are going to draft me. And the odds of that happening, and you just sit in the draft room, and I'm like, are you kidding me? It's 5 till 8 in the morning, all right? And this was a slam dunk. We were, you know, there was only one team. And so, all right, we hung up. Sure enough, the Texans selected Owen Daniel. We traded down with the Philadelphia Eagles. We acquired Hollis Thomas. They drafted Max Gene-Gillis. And then we selected out of Bloomsburg, Jari Evans. So sometimes, look, that was a win-win, really, the careers both players had, but a huge break for us in getting a fantastic starting guard, potentially Hall of Fame guard. And so, fifth round, he's going to be an honorary member of this draft class because I don't know that he goes into our Hall of Fame. Certainly we'll invite him back because he lives here half the year, but Rob Ninkovich, out of Purdue, we had Rob twice, and the last time I told him I thought he was going to be a long snapper, and then he went on to win 2 Super Bowls with the New England Patriots, playing outside linebacker and basically having a fantastic career. So we didn't have the right vision. In the sixth round, we drafted the Fred Biletnikoff winner out of Oregon State. I believe his name is Mike Haas. Mm-hmm. And Mike was a real productive receiver, a player we had seen a lot on film, obviously was decorated. And then in the first of the seventh round selections, we took Zach Strief, and that leads us to our compensatory selection, Marcus Colston. So in these draft meetings, it's easy to focus your energies on the first round. Typically the media, most of the fan base does. It's hard to speculate into the later rounds. And at that time, Curtis Johnson, our receiver coach, had seen his tape. Now, mind you, it was somewhat grainy. So every once in a while, you'll get a tape from a smaller school, and you'll try to, we spent a lot of time trying to locate the number, what socks is he wearing, something that stands out. And so CJ had a real strong, high opinion. Johnny Morton, the same way, a high opinion. I know one of our area scouts did. And look, I'll be honest with you, you do look for traits. So we're not in that room just throwing darts at names in the seventh round. But he had these traits. Now, the route tree was limited. The offense he played in, you didn't get to see a lot of what we were going to see for the next however many years that he excelled here. In fact, we weren't going to see that at the rookie camp either. All right. That rookie camp, we were inside, outside, and this Mike Haas was catching a ton of balls. I mean, I'm telling you, playing the slot. And meanwhile, Marcus, I don't know if it was the heat here or if it was his back. It was a combination of a few things. But between, Johnny Moe and CJ were like drill sergeant one and drill sergeant two. I mean, the first person you hear at our practice in those, Joe Horn didn't know what to think, but it was Curtis Johnson. All right. And it became kind of legendary each year. It didn't matter who the receivers were. And so, man, I know there was a point. I heard Zach Strief's point last year in his speech, but I know there was this point with Marcus where he was thinking, man, is this it? Am I in the NFL and do I belong? But his spring, I would say, was just somewhat okay. The most amazing thing happened, though, throughout that summer and into training camp, and I would say the early weeks of training camp. Deuce, we were waiting on your knee. You were on a pitch count. Drew Brees, we were waiting on his shoulder. He was on a pitch count. All right. Reggie was doing Gatorade commercials, and he was rolling. He was doing outstanding. All right. Dante Stallworth, truth be known, was kind of bugging me a little bit, and he and I laugh about that to this point. But, I mean, that was kind of a little bit, I would say, with some grief and or some frustration. And all of a sudden, this Colston each day just, boom, just keeps making pars and birdies, just keep putting practices together where, it goes from, I can remember the first deep inning caught on the grass field that was 60 yards long, and we had the arena ball blow up sidelines in case you went out of bounds. These things caught you. And I remember that first week and then that second week, and at some point into that first month of training camp, feeling like, hey, we got our starting split end. We got our starting split end. And look, I said this already. I was ready to trade Dante Stallworth. All right. And again, he and I have a relationship now where it's easy for me to say that, but now it became much easier. And to see then the way this player played, not only in his rookie year, but I'm telling you, it was boom, the most consistent. You knew exactly what you were going to get. I can recall his first touchdown catch at Cleveland. If you were expecting a fun end zone dance or anything, you were just going to get a flip. In the pylon he caught against the Green Bay Packers, we were down 13-0. We came back and won that game in week two. to lead up to Governor, the game you were referencing, and to watch the career he had in the I want to use the right word, I don't know if it's symbiotic relationship, or that cohesiveness he and Drew shared that was earned post-practice. It was earned throughout countless days at Millsaps. And I know Drew would say the same thing, but man, the consistency and the professionalism and knowing exactly what you were going to get week in and week out. And mind you, what you were going to get was the all-time leading receiver in the history of this organization. And he had excellent hands. On occasion, twice a year, he'd have not a hard drop, but an easy one that would just go dump. And it was somewhat unusual because it didn't happen often. His catch rate ratio was phenomenal. But when he would have one of these, like I would turn and I would want to give, I don't know. And so Marcus was smart enough to where he would exit the field opposite of where I was always. Somewhat frustrating. Because I think we were on cords then, and you can actually see this take place in the Super Bowl. We ran a gap play action pass, deep 18-yard hook. The ball kind of came here, boom, on the ground. And then right away, like he just kind of moved across the 40-yard line, and I was down at the 30, the other 30. And then I would be like weaving through players to try to find them. That didn't happen often. He was very humble in how he played, very respected as a teammate, and again, as I mentioned with Reggie and I'm mentioning with him, I mean, I just, as a coach, it was, you get 3 years the first time coaches. You have to do something in 3 years. I remember telling our team this, and these guys might remember this, history, or what we call that term we use for culture. I referenced the Steelers, and I said, you guys would consider this organization one that has winning ways. And yet, if you looked at 1970, 71, 72, and Chuck Knoll was there, there were some lean seasons and prior to that. And so very quickly, what we know, or what I grew up with as an organization that became one of a winning culture, a winning tradition, happened not over 40 years, but happened over two or three really good, outstanding draft classes. And man, they made that change. And we referenced that at that point. And so to be able to visit with some of these players now and to personally thank these players now, because for a young coach, there's certain breaks you need. And man, there are a lot of talented players that don't end up in the right system that we never hear a lot about their careers. And I think there are a lot of talented coaches that so too end up maybe in not the right situation, and we never get to hear about their successes. And I feel like a lot of things went in our direction. So it's with great honor that I'm taking up some of Marcus's time. He asked me, he said, could you go five into mine? To present Marcus Colston into the Saints Hall of Fame.
I mean, I think you guys know at this point, time is definitely not going to be, it's not going to be a challenge for me to really fill in the gap. But Sean, I really appreciate really all of those words. Over our 10 years together, can't say I heard too many, can't say I heard too many words, that were really that kind and that, but it's truly an honor to be here and really share the stage with these three extraordinary people, to be a part of this extraordinary organization that has become a second family, and you know, to really be able to have this opportunity to look back on the 10 years that I spent here. And it's just when you come in the league as a seventh round pick, you know, something like this really isn't on your radar. You know, you're kind of in survival mode day in and day out, and you're hoping that the mindset is really you're hoping that you did enough that day to keep your job. And you know, Sean referenced my rookie mini camp on numerous occasions, but and I think it really taught me a couple of different things. You know, one, you know, I had never been to New Orleans prior to getting drafted here. It'd always been a football fan since I was, you know, 4 or 5 years old. And, you know, some of that history that Sean referenced, I mean, I'd seen it and, you know, watched it growing up. You know, so when you get drafted in the seventh round, one, you're not really super excited to still be on the board. You're really not super excited to go to a 3-13 team. You know, for me, I was, you know, two or three picks away from, you know, being able to find what I thought would be the best destination to go and try to make a roster as a free agent. And, you know, having the ability to get drafted here and coming down here as a 22-year-old, never been into New Orleans, and, you know, just seeing the aftermath of Hurricane Katrina, you know, Reggie kind of touched on it. You instantly feel like, you know, this is bigger than football. You know, and the opportunity to get into training camp, you know, continue to fight for a job every day, you know, be around guys like Deuce and be around guys like Joe and really be around guys like Reggie, who, you know, from across the country, you know, watched and admired. I mean, he's probably the best college football player I'd ever seen. So you get into a locker room with guys like that, and you know you have an opportunity to really go out and fight every day. You know, that's really what this team and this foundation of this team has really been about since 2006. You know, had the pleasure to come down and support Pierre Thomas and Lance Moore last year, as you know, into the Saints Hall of Fame as undrafted free agents. And what you quickly realize is that the opportunity to come and play at this organization, the one thing that you're going to get is an opportunity to show what you can do. And, you know, I'm obviously, you know, for forever grateful, forever indebted to this organization for getting that opportunity. The Bentons, Mr. Loomis, the rest of the front office, coaching staff, you know, just the opportunity to go out and compete every day on a fair playing field. I mean, that's all you can ask for as a competitor. And, you know, I really took a lot of pride in, you know, competing every day and really being a teammate that can be depended upon, being someone that you know exactly what you're going to get every single day, day in, day out. You know, even in the dog days of Millsaps, you know, that's what the job required. And, you know, just truly humbled to be on this stage, truly humbled to be a part of this great Hall of Fame with so many other great players. And, you know, just truly, you guys can probably believe this, really at a loss of words. So thank you to the Saints organization. Thank you to everyone that's a part of this decision-making process. Look forward to seeing the rest of this 06 class, you know, here in years to come.
I think if you do the math, and I'm fairly certain six members of that class played 10 or more years, and I think the total number of years played in that class, which I think is only happened once, is north of 70 years in one draft class. When you look at all those players that we referenced earlier. So congratulations to both you guys. Governor, Ken?
Media selection committee, many of those individuals are in the room. We salute them for the job that they do with these selections every year. Speaking of which, questions for Kathleen, Reggie, or Marcus? Go right ahead.
Question for Reggie and Marcus. When you look back, when you walked Mike when you first got here, yeah, to where he is now, what does it mean to you just to see how far the city is going?
It means a lot, you know, knowing that we were part of that process. You know, I think one of the
best parts of our job, what we were able to do, was to be able to go out into the city and to be able to physically help people rebuild their homes. You know, that to me, that's the piece that Colson is talking about. That's when, you know, you realize that this is bigger than football, right? This is about, you know, helping people who are in need, and people who are right here in our backyard. And so, you know, I remember, you know, one night after practice, something like that, and it was almost like a ghost town, right? It's just nobody in the streets. You know, obviously there weren't a lot of businesses that were open late at that time. And, you know, now to help just bring back hope and faith into this organization, to the team, to the coaches, to Mrs. Benson, to the front office, to everybody, it's really cool to, you know, to be a part of something like that. And it's really special, and it's something that, you know, you can never take for granted, because you know, to me, that's what sports is about, you know, is being able to, you know, go the extra mile and not just say, I'm just going to show up and collect a check, but, you know, to be able to actually impact and affect people's lives, you know, outside of the arena. You know, to me, that's part of our job description. You know, that's why we're here. And that's the most rewarding part about what we're able to do, you know, is being able to do all those things.
I mean, I think for me, I say it often, just talking about pro sports, really, it's the business of selling hope, right? You get into the draft and you got 32 teams that every single year they feel like they have aspirations to win the Super Bowl. And it's really no different with the fan base. And, you know, the opportunity to be here and really not only represent New Orleans, but understand that you're representing the entire Gulf region, you know, just to play a small role in that resurgence and, you know, just have the opportunity to interact with people and understand the impact that you've made on their lives over the years, there's no feeling in the world like that.
True story. So every year, coach has a bat game, and the bat game, I'm assuming that you guys don't know a whole lot about that, so I'll just kind of bring you up to speed. But, you know, when coach hands out a bat, you know, he picks a game, we have to be the most physical team on that football field. We have to, you know, we want to be the team that we start fast, and you know, we're the most physical team in every aspect of the game. And so before the game, I'm in the locker room with the bat, and I'm thinking, like, man, I want to motivate. I want to somehow make an impact early on in this either in warm-ups or something to where I can get this team jacked up, right? And so I'm talking to the guys in the locker room. I'm like, I think I want to bring the bat out. And they're all like, yeah, you should do that. You should bring the bat out. But – now when I look back on it, nobody else wanted to also bring the bat out. It was just me. And so they were kind of egging me on to do it. And then, you know, I remember running out on the field with the bat and then immediately looking to the sideline, and coach was like, come here. And, yeah. So, yeah, now the pressure was on me at that point. I had no choice but to go out and ball. So, you know, thankfully, you know, I was able to go out and you know, play well that game.
Marcus, can you talk about the first touchdown catch in that game there? How much confidence did that give you? And did you think there would be that many more Drew after that?
I mean, I remember the route. We were right inside the red zone, and I ran a Harvey route against Ralph Brown. I think it was. But yeah, it was one of those things that it didn't really register for me at the time. You know, I got in the end zone, and you know, it was kind of like I'd been there, you know, a bunch before. But you know, for me, it was still that mindset of I really wasn't. I'd started the game, but I really wasn't comfortable in the fact that I was a starter. You know, so for me, that was just kind of my internal motivation. And you know, it kind of kept me in a headspace where I was able to kind of really focus on the here and now, and to imagine that, you know, 70 some odd touchdowns later that would be the end result. I can't say that's something that was ever on my radar.
Marcus, can you go through each of the 72?
See, there was a couple hits on some of them. I might.
It's special to be able to go into, you know, draft class with Colson. And one thing that Joe Vitt used to always say is that we're going to walk together forever, you know, because of what we're able to accomplish here in this city, you know, on this football team. And it is true, because a lot of these guys are still some of my best friends to this day. You know, I was just texting Roman and Vilma about coming down to my charity golf weekend end of this month. And so, you know, we still talk all the time. We're in this group chat. Well, Orny somehow's in this group chat. I don't know how he got in there, but Orny somehow in the group chat. But it's you know, it is true though, you know, because of the people who've come from all different, you know, walks of life, and we come together and we're able to accomplish this one thing that, you know, what Coach Vitt used to always say is that we're going to walk together forever, and that is true. You know, I couldn't be more proud to go into the draft class with Colston. I have to say, this is the most I've ever heard him speak, like literally ever. He's you know, we call his nickname was Quiet Storm for a reason. It's because, you know, he didn't talk a whole lot, but he led by example. And you know, that's what you want, you know, out of your players. It's somebody that's going to punch the clock every time he steps on the football field, whether it's practice, whether it's in the film room, in the weight room, during games. And Coach was absolutely correct. You know, you knew exactly what you were going to get out of Colston. He was Mr. Consistent. Again, you know, didn't say a whole lot, but he didn't have to, because he said a lot with his demeanor on the football field, with the way he played the game, with the consistent just being able to, you know, to rely for Drew, being able to rely on him and us as well. You know, I got to imagine as a quarterback, you know, that's a breath of fresh air, having a receiver like Colson that, you know, you can depend on all the time, to be in the right place, do the right things, not only on the football field, but on and off the field.
Larry, I think I'd say it's really a testament to this organization. You know, the fact that, you know, Sean opened it up. I mean, the first pick of the draft and the last pick of the 2006 draft going into the hall at the same time. You know, I think there's a lot of organizations and coaches that give lip service to, you know, how they evaluate players. But I remember vividly, you know, the mindset here was, it doesn't matter how you get here. And, you know, for this to be, you know, kind of the end result. And like I said before, to have Lance and Pierre go in the year prior, I think it speaks volumes about how this organization really evaluates players. It really, you know, makes it a point to make sure that the best team is on the field at any given point. And, you know, when you can play for an organization like that, and, you know, have guys like Reggie that come in as the second pick, and, you know, there he came in with a work ethic that was second to none. When you can build a roster from top to bottom like that, I mean, this is why you've seen the success over the last 10, 15 years.
Thank you.
Oh, this is the highlight of my life. The last thing I would ever have imagined getting was the phone call saying, we want to induct you into the Saints Hall of Fame. Now think about that. For an average person like me, just minding my own business and getting a call from Ken saying I'd be in the Saints Hall of Fame. And I was shocked, really, deeply honored. And I just admire what's going on here with the team. I think Gail Benson is doing an amazing job. And I'm very, very proud of her on behalf of all of the citizens of Louisiana, but especially all the women of Louisiana. So this is quite a memory marker for us, for me and my family. I have five surviving children, and some of my grandsons are here today, and we are just as proud as can be. We've always been Saints fans, of course. We've been through those years of total frustration and those years of total elation, and so it's just been just regular Saints fans, I think, experiences. But this is extraordinary, and I'm just so proud to be with these guys. A little small point of history that some may or may not remember is I used to be a coach's wife. My husband coached in high school, but I wasn't his wife then. And he coached at the University of Louisiana in Lafayette. And we got married while he was coaching. So as a coach's wife, I was surrounded by guys like this and coaches, big guys. And one day I walked into one of the hotels here with one of my friends, and she said, what's going on in this hotel? I mean, look at all these huge men. I said, I didn't see it, but I bet it's a coaches convention. And that's what it was exactly. We just, as a family, are very devoted to making Louisiana as good as it can be. And I think the Saints exemplify that. We could not have had the same kind of recovery that we actually have experienced without the backup. The Saints created enthusiasm. The building did become a symbol of victory. Mm-hmm. And people who were working on smaller properties looked at that and said, if anybody can do that huge property, we can do our property. And small properties were not much easier to recover than large properties. But it just all came to pass. And I'm just so proud to be a part of it. And I'm very proud to feel like I'm a family member of the Saints now. So thank you so much.
Thank you. I will say this, though. I'm reading this book right now by Moz Monroe called The Spirit of Leadership. And in that book, it talks about just how we all have that spirit of leadership inside of us and how we all are here for a purpose, right? And, you know, without Mrs. Blanco, taking initiative to make sure, that we were able to have, our stadium, redone and put back together. And we wouldn't have been able to go in there and do the work that we did that year, it's so special to hear your story and to hear, just how everybody, a lot of different people, have had, their own stamp on, kind of restoring the city or restoring the Superdome or just helping in some way, shape, or form, because, we all have a purpose here. And, Mrs. Blanco was a huge piece of that. So I'm happy to be going into the Hall of Fame with you as well. So thank you.
Last one. Anyone else?
Marcus, are you having a happy birthday?
Is it birthday? What? You see? That's how quiet he is. He didn't even tell you it's his birthday. Dang. Happy birthday, man. Wow.
How old are you?
Question. Yeah, hold on. Yeah, that's the question. Yeah,
36 today.
Ooh, flying boy at a time, flying.
Once again, we want to congratulate Kathleen. We want to focus for this accomplishment. Again, the actual induction will take place on October 25th at Club 44, that night of the weekend of the Arizona Cardinals noon game that Sunday. So congratulations to these three. Thanks to Coach Baden for helping make this special, to Gail and Mickey for making this as special as they've made it as well. If you guys want to talk to any of the three honorees, you can feel free to do so. Thank you for being here.
Thank you.